the good days changed. You know, the good days back in patrol would be when you could actually affect something positive for the community. Even as a detective, and then later when I promoted, those good days were more about mentoring people or helping those behind you, never forgetting where you came from.
Today on Meet the Voter and Timelines, we have candidate for Washoe County Sheriff, Kim Myers. We want to thank the RMC for making this episode possible through their silver sponsors. Thank you, silver sponsors.
Welcome to Meet the Voter, sponsored by the RMC and their silver sponsors.
Thank you, Bill, for letting me be here. I appreciate the opportunity.
Very good. And I want to thank you for running for sheriff, and as well as being a part of law enforcement and keeping us safe here in Washoe County.
Well, thank you very much.
Over the years. Definitely appreciate it very much. And I know it's a tough thing to run. We're not really talking about your sheriff's race today, but we want to find out more about you and your background. So where'd you grow up and what brought you to law enforcement?
We came here when I was 9 years old from California, and I've been here the 40 years since. So I pretty much consider this is where I grew up.
You know, it seems pretty neat. A lot of people, my daughters came here when they were 10 and 13 with us after I retired from the military. So I love Reno. It's a great town. It's in Sparks. It's a wonderful area. So if you don't mind, where did you come from in California?
We came from the San Fernando Valley, which was actually Sylmar is the city that I came from. City might be a big word, but.
Well, your family came up here.
And yes.
It's a great area. Seems like a great place to grow up.
Yes, it was.
What type of sports did you do when you're here?
I only played volleyball and softball when I was in school.
Very good. And so you went to elementary, and then where did you go to high school?
I went to high school at Reno High and graduated from Reno High.
Oh, my daughters will be happy with that. Yeah, they're both at Reno. Woo-hoo. Reno, yeah, we like Reno High School.
Yeah,
I'm a
Huskies.
Little biased. I'm a little biased. That's one area I'm biased, the Huskies.
Yep.
Wonderful high school, one of the oldest high schools.
Yes,
if not the oldest high school here.
Yeah.
Very good. So you going on, after you got out of school, how did you get in law enforcement, and did you go to college?
I had scholarships for UNR, so I went on to UNR, graduated with a bachelor's in criminal justice, and then eventually got hired at the sheriff's office in 1991.
When did you know you wanted to go into criminal justice?
It actually was a fluke. I had to take some electives, and I took criminal justice as an elective because it filled that spot. And it was the then sheriff that was teaching the class. And it really clicked with me that that's what I wanted to do. I had entered UNR with the intent to become range wildlife and forestry. That was my major then. But then after sitting through Sheriff Swinney's class, I was like, wait a minute, that's what I want to do.
That's good. Yeah. That's good. And I guess even in that other career, in some aspects, you can get sworn in parks and things
yes.
like that.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. The opportunities were much smaller, but yes.
Right. I got a true story. I tried to apply for all the national parks when I was in high school senior. And I just wanted to do some kind of summer job. I had advanced first aid equivalent to EMT now, and I couldn't get a job, but I got into West Point. So.
Well, I guess that was the way it was supposed to be.
It's a hard competitive area to get into.
Those are coveted jobs.
Yeah, hard to get into. I think you have to know somebody.
Yes, I think so.
So very good. So going on, that's a good lead in to for young people. What would you say tell young people or anybody who wants to go into law enforcement? Because a lot of people go in when they're 40s or after a second career.
Sure.
Some people go, I think, is it 21 the minimum age here?
Yes. Yes, 21 to get into the academy. So there's obviously that piece of actually getting through the process to apply. And then there's the academy. And then there's, you know, your time on the department as far as a probationary time. And then all the time after that.
So you were in the sheriff's department the entire time?
The entire time at the sheriff's office,
So what were the process of going from Reno and getting hired in the sheriff's department? How long did that take? And what did you have to do?
From going from UNR
to... Excuse me, from Reno. UNR.
Yeah. It took a good probably 8 months from application to actually getting the phone call asking me if I was still interested in becoming a deputy sheriff.
Well, that's really fast talking to people. And you did it the very first year out, right away?
Yes. Yes. Wow. I applied as soon as those openings came up. I applied for the sheriff's office and did some, worked as a pharmacy tech in between.
Uh-huh.
So,
that's an interesting background.
Yeah.
Pharmacy tech and criminal law.
Yeah. Well,
so you know your drugs.
I know my drugs. I did then. I don't know them as well now. So
wow. So when you went to post, what was post like when you went? Is it the same as it is today?
No. Originally, we were hired under a different career path. So we were originally hired as Category 3. So we had a very short academy that consisted of about 6 or 7 weeks, where it was just what we called like a mini academy. It wasn't until under another sheriff, Sheriff Kirkland, where he decided we would all become Category 1s. That's when I went to post. So I already had 6 years on the department when I went to the big academy. And it's evolved, obviously, a little over time since then. That was in 1997 that I went to that big academy. And since then, it's evolved a little bit, as we've had to. Obviously, law enforcement is very different. There are new laws on the books. And just society itself has evolved. So it's had to change with the times.
So when you were 3, was that sworn back then?
Yes, it was still sworn. Yes, we were labeled as detention deputy sheriffs. So we would have career path just in the detention facility.
Specializing back then.
Yes, yeah.
So, I see. And before you go on the street.
Yes.
That makes sense. Now, today they go into post and they're all, if they're full, there's a reserve and there's active, right?
Yes. We do have a reserve program. I don't know that every sheriff's office has that, but we do have that reserve program. And then there's actually the sworn, and everybody goes through the same academy. So there's not the career pathing right now.
So all the different agencies, the PDs and they all go to the same place. Is that the same academy you went to?
Yes. High Sierra.
High Sierra. Yep. So you know the modern academy. When did they build that?
When I went through, it was actually held at TMCC.
Okay.
It was part of the TMCC campus. And then they added it in over there. Not exactly when that building was built, it later moved over there. So I believe it's probably been there, I would say at least 10 years now, but it could even be longer.
So someone right out of high school could go to TMCC now today, and they still have probably law enforcement there? Is that another track? You went right to UMR.
Yes, they do have their own 2-year program that you can still take your criminal justice classes up there.
And then you could work on an advanced degree because you could start fairly young at 21.
Sure.
You're probably around 22, 23, I'm guessing.
I was 23 when I went in, yep.
That's good.
Yep.
That's fun.
Yeah.
So interesting track because we're always looking. The main thing of this is going to be on timelines too, and we go into like careers and what people might want to do. And a lot of people listen to that Timelines podcast. It's a podcast and a lot of people listen because it's about careers and success and what you need to do to be successful.
Right.
So that leads us into some of the other things. So career in law enforcement, you have good days and bad days. I want to talk about what are some of the bad times that are some of the rough times that you have to get through. Not every career is perfect all the time, even though there's rewards.
Right. And I would have to say over the 24 plus years that I was there, you know, those bad times changed over time. When I was in the jail, sometimes it was tough to be in the jail with, you know, 800 plus or minus inmates, and then also to have an agency that at times would suffer from low morale. Sometimes just getting through that day could be difficult. When I went out onto the street and when I went into detectives, then those days kind of changed. You know, it's when you become a spectator to someone's personal tragedy, sometimes that's very difficult to get through. When you're a detective and I was a detective in crimes against children, sometimes hearing their stories is very difficult to get through. So over the time, those difficult days changed. The rewards changed. The good days changed. You know, the good days back in patrol would be when you could actually affect something positive for the community. Even as a detective and then later when I promoted, those good days were more about mentoring people or helping those behind you, never forgetting where you came from, and then being able to help people that were in that same position that you were in.
Pretty good, sort of brought those together. So those best days, what was your best day, you think? One of your best days?
One of my best days? Selfishly, I could say some of my best days were when we actually were able to get a conviction on somebody. But there were other, you know, personal best days, like when I actually graduated from emergency vehicle operations course and I didn't crash my car. So that was a great day.
I
didn't crash. Nobody got dead.
You could back up too.
Knock off all those cones. So,
yeah.
So there were those little highlights along the way. Obviously when I promoted was a great day, but personally, like when I gave birth, that was a great day.
Oh, yeah, for
two times.
That makes
yeah.
sense. It's good.
Yeah, personally.
So you've got a young family. That's a good thing to point out. And yeah. we'll talk about that a little bit in the second half.
Okay.
Because that's, yeah, I can relate to that.
Yeah, I bet.
So without ado, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll come right back in a couple seconds.
This is Bill Conrad, and I'd like to thank the board of the RMC and the silver sponsors for sponsoring Meet the Voter and other programs similar to this one. Their contributions helps get this information out through new media and, of course, RMC TV. So for more information, just go over to RepublicanMen'sClub.org or MeetTheVoter.com. Now, without further ado, let's get right back into this episode.
We're coming back off a break, and we're talking about your family. Since you have two kids...
Yes.
Young kids, 14,
yep.
16.
Yep.
That's a sacrifice. So how do you balance your family with business and becoming sheriff?
And the fortunate thing, honestly, Bill, is actually balancing that piece now will be much easier than when they were younger. And both my husband and I were both in law enforcement working shift work when those kids were little, much more difficult. So at least, you know, other than just throwing Cheerios at them when they were younger, at least now they can kind of fend for themselves and make their
yeah.
own meals.
Yeah, they grow up fast.
Yes. You know, so at least that piece I actually think will be easier than when they were younger. And it is about understanding the value of time. And that was one of the things that my parents taught me. And they taught me that in their death, the value of time. And just making time, even if it's just stealing those minutes day to day, just to ask how their day was and making those personal connections, I think is invaluable. It's not about the material things. It's not about the stuff. It's about building memories, in my opinion. And that's the true value. So anytime that I can just take a breather with them and just ask them, tell me about your day, you know, then that's a win. And I'm much better at doing that now than when they were younger and things seemed so much more hectic trying to get all that accomplished. So I don't think it's going to be as hard. And, you know, and they don't want to be around me that much either anymore, Bill. So so it makes it easier, I guess.
You know, I can relate to that. My daughter's about to turn 18, and she's been accepted to UNR, and she wants to go live in the dorms.
Yeah. Oh, gosh.
Did you live in the dorms?
No.
You lived at
home? No, I lived at home. Yeah.
You think that's
yeah.
a good move, living in the dorms?
It was not for me. That was not a choice that would have been.
She's
know,
not going to get a car.
Well, and financially, it yeah. didn't make sense to me. I was paying my own way.
Yeah. Well, she's going to work.
Yeah.
We're a big
so,
believer that you should work
yep,
when you're going to
yep,
school.
That's what I did. So it made better financial sense for me to stay home.
Well, that's
so,
good.
Yeah.
That's good. So that's a perfect segue for your life and success principles and leadership. And you've got three. Let me mention integrity, true to who you are, and empower your those who work for you.
Yes.
Sort of a leadership principle.
Yes.
So tell me, what does integrity mean to you?
Integrity for me means doing the right thing, even though it may not be the popular thing. Sometimes making that tough decision and standing up for what you believe in. And then having that voice, finding that voice and doing the right thing. And sometimes it's not easy, you know, but I think if you don't have integrity, then you're a lost individual anyway. So...
Well, you definitely need integrity in law enforcement
yes.
and honesty. That's
yes.
one of the basics of
yes.
our law enforcement. And we do. People don't understand that our law enforcement, compared to other parts of the world, is above reproach.
Absolutely.
I know you go through lie detectors to get
yep.
in and internal affairs and
yep.
all those good things that are
yep.
checkmarked. Sometimes I think, I don't want to go to politics, but sometimes I think the civilian community, the other community, doesn't quite understand how good a law enforcement they have. I've been around the world. And
yes.
And we really do everywhere.
Yes, I agree.
So the next one is true to who you are. That can be both leadership and it can be a personal principle. So
yes.
what is it for you?
Yes, for me, it's both. And when I first started law enforcement, the only role models we had, because there weren't many women in law enforcement at the time, so our role models were the men. But what I quickly realized is I could not conduct myself like the men could. I needed to find my own style. I needed to be true to who Kim was at that time. Although I was naive at the time, I had to quickly learn a style that would work for me with people of all kinds of walks of life, people that were in custody, people that were not in custody, general public, being able to deal with them in a way that was authentic to me. Because the one thing that people can pick up on is when you're not being authentic and when you're not being yourself. And I think it actually goes to that same thing as being a leader. You have to be true to who you are as a leader. So in every position, I felt I was a leader, but I needed to be able to not do it like anybody else did it, but do it how I wanted to do it and how I felt they wanted to be led. You know, so I just think it's important to know who you are and what makes you tick.
Very good. That's excellent. And then finally, empowerment. Now, empowerment, is that empower the people who work for you, or what's that mean to you?
Yes, empowering others to do the best job that they can. So, and sometimes what that means is getting out of their way so they can do their job. Often in a leadership role, you're supervising people that may know more than you do about what they're doing. And sometimes your role is to provide either a barrier so that they can do their job, or it's your role to support them so that in the best way possible so that they can do their job, and just getting out of their way and allowing them to rise to the level.
So the Sheriff's Department here in Washoe County is quite large, I assume.
Yes.
And there's a lot of different levels. How is it structured?
So we do have a civilian side and we have the commission side. So on the commission side, at the low end is just a deputy sheriff, and then you rise through the ranks if you choose. So within the deputy sheriff position, you can become a detective, but it's not rank. It's just a different label, but you're still like a detective deputy sheriff. When you promote, the first level you go to a sergeant, then lieutenant, then captain. And then if you rise up beyond that, it's an appointed position to be in the front office, so the executive offices. And from time to time, they change the name. Mm-hmm. So it used to be assistant sheriffs. Now it's back to chief deputies.
Chief deputies. So you have five captains. I know that. And then above the captain, between the sheriff is?
Are the chief deputies.
Two chief deputies?
There are three right now. Deputies. Yeah.
Operations.
Yeah. And then there's the undersheriff.
Oh, the undersheriff.
And now, then there's the sheriff.
Oh, so the undersheriff takes over for the sheriff. Yeah. Now that's appointed?
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
Is it
not
like
elected.
The sheriff? Who appoints?
The sheriff.
Oh, the sheriff does.
Yeah. Not, yeah, the sheriff picks all those people in the front office.
So the commission has nothing to do with it.
Right.
It's like supervisors in California, commissioners here in Nevada.
Yes.
Commissioners are out of that. It's all the sheriff.
Right.
Wow. That's a lot of that's a lot of power.
Authority.
For the sheriff. Authority.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. You learn something new all the time. So in closing, how can the listener find you?
I would love for them to go to my website. So my website is kimmeyerforsheriff.com. You can get me on email at kim@kimmeyerforsheriff, and Meyer is M-E-Y-E-R.
Okay.
And then my phone number, they're always welcome to call me, is 775-386-2481. And if I don't answer, please leave me a message and I'll get back to you.
And we'll have those contact informations on this post, because you'll have a post on RMC and New Media Timelines and Meet the Voter. Meet the
Excellent.
Voter is sort of out there too. So Excellent. Three different places.
Excellent. I thank
so
you for
everywhere.
For asking for that.
Well, it's not quite over yet. We've got a couple more questions, and these are really important questions. So we love Reno and Sparks. We love the Valley. Not the Valley. The area. We just love it here.
Yeah.
And it is a wonderful place. That's why I always like to push here. But it's growing so fast, too.
Yes, indeed.
My wife's in real estate, and I won't get this politics. She's talking, they got to slow down.
Right, yes.
Once you get here, because a lot of people are coming here.
Yeah.
But when you do come here or visit or stay, where are the places we should go to eat?
Okay, so I would have to hands down say you need to go to Mari and Chewy's Mexican Kitchen. It's in Midtown.
Mm-hmm.
You can't miss it. It's in the Styx Shopping Center. So they kind of anchor that little shopping center. So hands down, he's such a wonderful person. He's like, you know, eating with your favorite person. So so definitely Mari and Chewy's. And then if you're into Thai food and you're over in Sparks, I would definitely say go to Sawasdee, which is right next to the Raley's on Pyramid and McCarran. So in the Raley Shopping Center, they're right next door.
Very good. And there's coffee shops everywhere around.
Of course. Yes.
So law enforcement likes coffee shops, right?
Yep. Yep.
We even have Dunkin' Donuts somewhere now.
Yep.
I know that came in.
Down south. Well, I don't know if there is one south. There's actually one in Sparks. There's Dutch Brothers that just came
in
down south.
That.
Yeah.
On
and
Virginia.
There actually is one in Midtown too. I just haven't been to it yet.
Yeah. Oh, Midtown. And Midtown's another part of Reno that's really evolved. And it's kind of an interesting place. It's sort of a local place.
Yes.
Midtown.
Yes.
Where locals go. And then finally, do I have any more questions? Oh, you're in great shape. What do you do to stay in shape?
I do a high intensity workout 3 times a week, but more importantly, I think I do and I teach yoga.
Oh, you teach yoga too?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. How long have you been teaching yoga?
For 3 years.
And you retired about how many years ago?
2 years. Two years in January.
So you teach, where do you teach?
I teach at the Yoga Pearl, and I volunteer teach for the Urban Lotus Project, which is a nonprofit that brings yoga to at-risk or underserved youth.
Very good. Well, Kim, I want to thank you. Good luck on your campaigns.
Thank you so much.
My hat's off to you. I know how hard it is to run for office.
Yes, I super appreciate this opportunity, Bill. So thank you, and thank you, RMC.
And you know, another thing I didn't mention, this is the second interview of the series, and you're going to be at the RMC on, I think it's the 22nd?
February 22nd, I believe. 22nd, I think you're right.
February 2018. So if you're in town, first-time guests are only like $12 to go to the luncheon.
Yes.
So it's a good deal. And you can bring people, too, if you're first-time guests at $12 a pop. So.
Yeah, not bad. Not bad for
a good lunch.
For
luncheon. Yeah. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Take care.
Hi, this is Bill, and thank you for watching. Go ahead and if you're not signed in, sign into your Gmail, go right up here and subscribe to RMC TV, and go over here, watch a couple more videos, link to our website at republicanmen'sclub.org, and finally, make sure you go down and leave a comment. The comments really help. See you on the next video.